Welcome to the Renal Research Institute's Frontiers in Kidney Medicine and Biology, where we share knowledge and advances in kidney research with the world. In this episode, we talk with Dr. Jeroen Coman, Professor of Chronic Kidney Failure at the University of Maastricht, about his research into Sherpas and dialysis patients. We go in depth about the oxygen cascade in hemodialysis patients and native high-altitude dwellers, and lessons learned from extreme physiology that benefit patients with end-stage kidney disease. It's a great pleasure to welcome Professor Jeroen Coman. He graduated from medical school in Maastricht in 1990, and in 1992, he did his PhD on the role of the venous system in hemodynamics during dialysis. He was then trained in internal medicine and nephrology. He spent time at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden, as a guest scientist. And in 2012, he was appointed a professor of chronic renal failure. And he was head of the Department of Nephrology at the Maastricht University Hospital. And since 2020, he is director at the University Maastricht University Institute of Education. So it's a great pleasure having you with us, Jeroen.
Thank you very much, Peter. I'm happy to be here.
Jeroen, you're really one of those scientists and clinicians who have such a broad scope of interest. You are interested in not just into medicine or nephrology. You are interested in connecting dots that seem so far away from each other. And you recently published a really interesting paper about oxygen and hypoxia in Sherpas and compare them to patients with chronic renal failure. And I think it was your trip to the Himalayas that actually made you think about this topic. Now, Jeroen, can you tell us a little bit more about this?
Yeah, sure. Actually, I took it. It was more a course from World Extreme Medicine. It's an organization. They organize courses and they learn you actually how to perform medicine in extreme environments. And I took this course. It's called Mountain Medicine. And actually, you make a trip to the Himalayas and you go. Actually, you hike yourself until 5,600 meters. So you also experience some kind of the altitude itself. And what you also saw, and you read, of course, also a lot about the specific region, is that people having lived there for generations, like Sherpa, and they can really perform very well, actually. And they're even under extreme physical demands, they can really perform very well, like climbing Mount Everest, aiding climbers there. And actually, I was really admiring actually what they did. But of course, I also learned from studies which you did, of course, at RRI, where you looked at dialysis patients actually in relation to hypoxemia. And dialysis patients with hypoxemia, they do not do really very well. They have an increased mortality. So I was actually struck by this difference in handling with reduced oxygen levels, how one group of people actually really tolerated this very well and could perform a lot of work and exercise there, whereas the other group of people for which we also take care perform badly under episodes of hypoxemia. And that was actually the idea, because this difference which I experienced myself, or which I saw myself, actually let me how to make this connection.
So Jeroen, this is really interesting that you started with a course on high altitude medicine and then came up with the idea to connect those two scenarios. So what were really the main insights you got from this research?
What you actually see is that Sherpa have adapted to her ambient, low ambient oxygen levels over generations, and actually there's some surprising adaptations there. And for instance, they have an increased number of capillaries in that tissue, so they can really extract oxygen very well. Whereas, for instance, dialysis patients, they have a reduced number of capillaries. There's an opposite over there. And what you actually see, if you look at Sherpa, they they adapted at different levels in the body to this low ambient oxygen levels. Whereas if you look at dialysis patients, they have actually can have problems all at different levels of these oxygen cascade, which can reinforce each other. So where the one group of people actually shows adaptation, the other group of patients, then the dialysis patients, show abnormalities as different levels of the oxygen cascade. And as you know, the oxygen cascade actually goes from ambient oxygen to the lungs, actually to the tissue themselves. And you can see that, yeah, that there's a lot of difference over there. And I hoped actually also that we could learn a little bit from these adaptations which had evolved in Sherpa over many generations, to that it could improve the care for our patients maybe in the future. That would lead to some new insights. But admittedly, this obviously will take a long time.
Did you learn something by comparing Sherpas with dialysis patients that really could be applied in the care for dialysis patients?
Yeah.
And when I talk about care, I really mean both diagnostically and therapeutically, but right, also in terms of basic science. Could you envision drugs, for example, or other intervention that would kind of convert dialysis patients who are so many of those are live under conditions of hypoxia and hypoxemia. Could you think about the intervention that convert them into a Sherpa-like oxygen metabolism?
Yeah, that would be great. Actually, there are two main differences actually at the end of the oxygen cascade, which could be of relevance. If you look at Sherpa, actually, if they as already mentioned, they have an increased number of capillaries, whereas dialysis patients have a reduced number of capillaries. That's one. And on the other hand, actually, the oxygen metabolism and handling in the mitochondria in Sherpa is much more efficient, and they have much less oxidative stress, whereas dialysis patients have an increased oxidative stress, and their oxygen handling at the mitochondrial level is not very efficient. Now, first looking into the capillaries, it's of course very difficult to increase your number of capillaries, but there's an interesting correlate. For instance, under hypoxemia, increased number levels of HIF can increase VEGF levels, and in this way also increase the number of capillaries. Whereas in dialysis patients, it's completely different mechanisms. The number of capillaries could be reduced because of reduced VEGF levels. And for instance, data from Jan Stietze have shown that high salt diets can reduce VEGF levels. So maybe even completely different handling high salt dietary intake, reducing that in dialysis patients could maybe indeed increase their, but it's very hypothetical, I must admit, also have a beneficial effect on their capillary density. Although to the best of my knowledge, this has not been studied yet. And of course, we could also think about, let's say, nitrate donors in patients on dialysis. But this also has not been studied yet. Whereas a little bit more evidence for is if we look at the mitochondria. For instance, there have been some NRF2 agonists actually which reduce oxidative stress, which could also be of relevance for dialysis patients. And even certain foods like polyphenols can also increase NRF2 levels and reduce oxidative stress. So maybe there could be some potential interventions which obviously need to be studied in a clinical setting.
I really love research that looks into quote-unquote experiments of nature and try to understand what can we learn from this. I think this is also very, really fascinating from an evolutionary standpoint.
Absolutely.
Do you know, Jeroen, are there actually any genetic differences between say, Sherpas and the tribe where Sherpas are recruited from and non-Sherpas that could make them more resistant against the effects of hypoxia and hypoxemia?
One is interesting. It's a very recent paper actually showing if polymorphism is in VEGF in Sherpa. That's one. And the other one is a little bit unexpected, and that's the fact that in contrast to people from Andes, actually Sherpa do not have polyglobulin, so increased hematocrit levels under hypoxia, under ambient hypoxia, which seems to be beneficial. So actually they have a polymorphism in the EPAS1 gene, as it's called, and actually this reduces HIF2 alpha, which plays a role in erythropoiesis. So actually This can be a beneficial adaptation at extreme altitudes, when normally you could have, as for instance, as seen in Andean people, chronic mountain sickness, which is nearly absent in Sherpa. So actually, this is somewhat unexpected in a way that the HIF2, which plays a role in erythropoiesis, is actually inhibited by one of these polymorphisms. It's a very ancient gene, this EPAS1 gene, which actually also was discovered in a very old and human race, the Denisovans. But it's a different story, actually, but it's very interesting.
Yeah, so actually it's interesting because the Denisovans, were identified not too far away. I mean, a few thousand miles away from the area where Sherpas live nowadays. So it's always interesting to speculate about.
It's interesting, although we do not know if there's any connection there. It's just a coincidence.
Of course. Now, just to drive that point home, because I think this might be of great interest to the audience. Unlike those people living at high altitude that usually develop polyglobulia, so high hematocrit levels, that's something the Sherpas don't. And yet the current hypothesis is that this is because of genetic differences.
Correct.
And indeed it might be beneficial to some extent because the blood viscosity doesn't increase as much as it might increase in other populations that dwell at high altitude.
That's indeed true. And because your normal response under these, let's say, chronic levels of ambient hypoxia, would be an increase in hematocrit, and it happens. It can happen. As already mentioned, if we look at the Andean population, but also people who came later to the Andes and worked, for instance, in the mines there, they developed severe chronic mountain sickness. Actually, that's. Which is absent, as already said, in Sherpa. So probably this is a beneficial adaptation.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, do you know, has anyone measured EPO levels in Sherpas and related this to red blood cell levels?
We should look that up. I don't know. This from now. There have been some expeditions actually gone to the Everest looking at differences between, let's say, people coming from other parts of the world and being exposed to altitude versus Sherpa. I'm not aware whether EPO levels themselves have been measured. They might, but I'm not sure. Part of these, it can also be a little bit difficult sometimes because part of these experiments were actually done at location.
In recent months and years, there was some research on what's called remote ischemic preconditioning. So could you just say a few words about this, explain to the audience what this is, and if there might actually be a relationship to the hypoxia, or hypoxemia, I should say, maybe experienced by Sherpas.
Yeah, you have remote preconditioning, actually, in which you have, let's say, for instance, you induce hypoxemia, let's say, for instance, in their hand, and in this way, actually hope to increase your tolerance for organ damage at different organs. That's one. But you also have another which comes a little bit closer. It's hypoxic preconditioning, where actually, let's say, low ambient oxygen levels are induced artificially, obviously, during relatively short periods of time. And this does not, of course, not come into the neighborhood of, let's say, the multi-generation adaptation of Sherpa. But it's an interesting model, and it comes back to what we call hormesis, actually, that mild stress, episodes of stress, might increase your tolerance for more severe stress at a later stage. And especially this hypoxic preconditioning has been used in a lot of in preclinical trials, animal trials, where it had a lot of beneficial effects on reducing brain injury, for instance, and brain damage. There's been somewhat less evidence in a clinical setting, in a way. Theoretically, it's a very good model. I think there's one point of caution. If you would induce this in an already susceptible population, where with multiple abnormalities at the oxygen cascade, you should also be, of course, a little bit careful with inducing severe hypoxemia, I think, even for relatively short periods of time. So there's, of course, also a pharmaceutical approach, like the PHD inhibitors, but maybe these could also have, now used for the treatment of anemia, they could also have potentially some effects apart from anemia. But also there, as far as I know, not an expert on that, evidence is still relatively limited, although it has been hypothesized that could also be used, for instance, to prevent neural damage, etc. But as far as I know, there are not many clinical data out there yet.
So if you would have funds, Jeroen, what kind of research would you want to conduct by further advancing this field of comparing, you know, people living in such extreme environments, such as SharePoint, with, say, CKD patients? What would be the primary hypothesis you would like to test, and what would you expect?
What would be interesting, I think, is to focus on two aspects, and I think that's already the mitochondrial efficiency, and that would be the capillary rarefaction in dialysis patients' capillary, and the increased capillary density in Sherpa. And that I would really be interesting to see what is indeed the mechanism for this large difference, and how could we, by let's say interventions, of which I already named a few, actually see if we could, for instance, enhance the handling of our energy handling at the cellular level in dialysis patients, which I think is a big problem. It's the increased oxidative stress has been known for a long period of time, can induce inflammation, can reduce oxygen handling, leads to toxicity at a cellular level. I think that's a big problem. And to dive more deeply into these two aspects, capillary rarefaction and mitochondrial efficiency, I think with different methods, either pharmaceutical, nutraceutical maybe, or even, let's say, with mild hypoxic preconditioning could be of interest. So these would be, I think that the topics which would be most relevant from a comparative point of view.
Yeah, and who knows, maybe a member in the audience says, oh yeah, cool project, and let's see if we can work together. Who knows, you know, Jeroen? I'm just wondering, because research requires frequently animal models, cell models, are you aware actually of animals living in high altitude?
Oh yeah,
that may have developed mechanisms that are somewhat developed, that can somehow be compared to the mechanisms that were developed in Sherpas?
One of is a kind of an unexpected animal. They live in hypoxic environments, but not at altitude. It's a naked mole rat, which is already, quite of a well-established method, an anti-aging model, actually, which also seemed to be very, very resistant to oxidative stress. So that's a very relevant relevant model. From animals living up altitude, let's say we have, for instance, certain geese who fly very high. I'm not aware that they are actually used to as a kind of a model, a testing model. Probably it may be very difficult to expose high altitude living geese to these kind of experiments. But there have been, I'm not completely aware of the details, but there have been tests on these on these animals, actually looking at their handling of oxygen. They can actually fly over the Himalaya, so they must be extremely tolerant of low oxygen levels. In the Everest, a lot of transport is done by yaks, who are very tolerant to ambient hypoxia. And you see they carry huge loads, and they really help trekkers and climbers a lot there. I'm also not so much aware if whether tests have been done on these animals. I'm sure there must be, but I cannot recall them yet.
Yeah, might be interesting to look into this, because this could be another dot that's worthwhile to connect back to the human condition. Yeah. And also when I think about questions related to allometry throughout the, say, the mammalian kingdom, there might be many interesting aspects to that. Yeah. So, Jeroen, as I said earlier with my introduction, you're a man of so broad interests. Can you tell us a little bit what your current research is, and what areas you think should be researched more intensely?
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's some of the research which I'm doing now is actually looking to sarcopenia methods, actually to the most optimal methods to detect sarcopenia in patients on dialysis, looking at different techniques and methodologies, because that's also a big problem, of course. As you know, I'm also interested in the phenotype of premature and accelerated aging in patients on dialysis, and muscle wasting is one of very important component there. A little bit disconnected from this, I think, but it's very interesting is also that we also together are looking at as I will sometimes like to call it, it's more of a kind of a mechanistic epidemiology, to look at together at large data sets from which we actually can learn about more basic mechanisms, actually looking at who can have impact on survival or well-being of patients on dialysis, and also they're connecting different risk factors like fluid overload, inflammation, muscle wasting, etc. So these are actually the main points of research at present, but I think it would be interesting to extend this also maybe a little bit more, let's say, as already said, mechanistic into the mechanisms of capillary rarefaction in patients on dialysis, and maybe that would be a topic for the next future.
Yes, especially I think the whole question about sarcopenia is something that will be a new frontier, I believe, in kidney research, because the metabolic activity of muscle, the importance of muscle for mobility, which has in turn effects on the hemodynamics, and I think cannot be overstated. Are there any advances in this research that you would want to highlight?
Yeah, there's a lot of research, of course, at being done at the basic level. What I'm actually interested in now as a kind of a follow-up project is to connect with other organ specialists like rheumatologists and pulmonologists and cardiologists, because I think that's the muscle wasting which we see in patients with chronic diseases can have a lot of common denominators, actually. And what I think to be very interesting is to look over different patients, patient population, and to see what we have in common there. Because we are looking always at, I'm looking at dialysis patients, my colleague, a rheumatologist, is just looking at patients with rheumatoid arthritis. But I think to look at the connections there, to the similarities between patients, I think, and if we could identify, which I'm sure there are, final common pathways of muscle wasting, that would, I think, give the field a big impetus. So I think that's one of my next projects, actually, is also going to do some kind of a literature search on what's all mechanistically known on all these different patient populations.
Yeah, and I think actually the research you and part together with RI and others did on the events before death, I think also highlights that there is maybe same processes in other chronic conditions, like what I think what you and others described, like, for example, this weight loss before people die, or this increase in inflammation. This has been identified in patients with chronic heart failure. This has been identified in patients with chronic infections like HIV/AIDS and others. So I think there is a lot of merit really to venture out of this, out of the box, and look what's going on in other fields and, and see what can we learn from this. The fact that we are sort of in boxes, I think that's, I guess, one of, we owe this in part to the Enlightenment era. And because separating things into small boxes has been so extremely successful in the history of science, but I guess it's time really to look outside of their own field and see what can be learned from that. Would you agree on that in principle?
Yeah, absolutely. And now we, of course, have the possibility of deep phenotyping. And I think it would be very interesting to look also if we have, let's say, common phenotypes, which I'm sure there are, between patients with chronic and different chronic organ diseases. But also you might have, the patients with, let's say, severe sarcopenia. You know that you have dialysis patients with severe sarcopenia. You have dialysis patients who do not have any sarcopenia at all, no fluid overload, no inflammation, and who seem to do very well. Whereas another group of patients actually, more or less unexpectedly, can do very badly. And actually to look at, let's say, more systems biology approach, connecting patients actually with chronic organ diseases who do very well, who do badly in a way, to see if you can actually by grouping them together and doing a deep phenotyping approach to look more at mechanisms actually which could tell us a little bit more why patients are doing well or not well at all and what could be potentially interveniable factors. I think that would be very interesting in a way.
In one of those series talks, we had a conversation with Dr. Richard Weller. I believe you know him. He is a dermatologist and actually moved into the field of, you know, hemodynamics because he identified mechanisms how UV light interacts with the NO system in the skin, and UV light actually results in lowering blood pressure. So I think this is another prime example how interactions between various fields really advance science, really advance our knowledge.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's fascinating to hear.
Now, I couldn't end this talk without raising this really fascinating research or thinking you did about the evolution of the kidney and where you really connected areas as divergent as geology, paleontology, with kidney medicine. Could you just say a few words about that? And you know how fascinated I was about your really, really wildly thinking outside of the box.
I don't have a large expertise in any of these fields. I don't have a large expertise in evolution, or even in geology or paleoclimatology. It's more that I'm kind of an interest. I have an interest in it, and that's how I try to connect these points. It's actually fascinating to see, but it was already, you know, it is already described in great detail by Homer Smith. And he wrote a very beautiful book on From Fish to Philosopher, and actually I was inspired to look at his thoughts and also to connect them a little bit with new insights on geology and continental changes, which are and changes in environments actually which were induced by plate tectonics. And actually if you look at this also from, let's say, more popular scientific books, you see that these different environments actually really stimulated evolution. Actually, in all this way, also stimulating evolution in different environments also needs adaptations in the kidney, because animals have to adapt differently. And I think it's really fascinating to see how these fields can be connected. But basically, I was just actually stimulated and fascinated by this wonderful book of Homer Smith, which is still, I think it was written in 1957, but it's still very, very worthwhile to read it. It hasn't lost any of its novelty and its value.
Yes, what I learned from this is really that First, we shouldn't let ourselves be bound by certain disciplines. And the other thing is that curiosity, which is the key driver of all our research interests, that this is really, we should just live curiosity and let no stone unturned, right?
It makes life a lot funner, actually, I must say. And also these kind of hobby projects, of course, they're just also interesting to do.
So, Jeroen, we have maybe a minute or so left, or 2 minutes. If you want to, what do you want the audience to take home?
I think that we can really, learn by looking at differences between people, and trying to look at mechanisms of these differences. Just let's say Sherpin and dialysis spaces were just an example, but I think it looking into physiology, physiology in more extreme environments can really help us learn a lot. I think also which might benefit maybe patient care in the future. It was also fascinating for me just to experience it and to also to dive into the literature there. And yeah, as I already mentioned, curiosity is it gives me a lot of fun in life. I think.
Thank you for being our guest today. At this front, I think, in medicine and biology. And I'm looking forward to meeting you in person at some point in time.
Absolutely, Vito. Thank you very much for the invitation. It was also, as always, great talking to you again. And thank you.
Thank you for joining the Renal Research Institute for this episode of Frontiers in Kidney Medicine and Biology. We invite you to engage with us on our social media channels and look forward to seeing you again soon for the next episode of Frontiers in Kidney Medicine and Biology.